Now, new research links raccoon dogs to COVID-19 origin. More details emerge about the origin of the COVID-19. Now, the origins of the virus can be linked to raccoon dogs to a Chinese market where the first COVID cases were identified. For more on this, let's now talk to infectious diseases expert, Dr. Ranjit Sulente. Good morning, Dr. Ranjit. Thanks for always taking our call.
Hi, Nikki. Good morning.
All right, so before anything else, what exactly does this new research tell us? What can we learn from the implications of this new data?
Well, for one, I think first we need to validate this, no? Because these are just preliminary data that, one, it has been proven that there is really a link of the origin of this SARS-CoV-2 virus coming from animals. And what we have experienced, Nikki, from before, no? Like the SARS-CoV-1, it was really documented that it came from bats. And then remember the MERS-CoV, that was the Middle East respiratory or severe respiratory virus. It was also discovered that there was the origin of that virus was coming from the camels, you know? And I think this latest report coming itself from an animal that was tested in the Wuhan market. And we know that Wuhan market was where the origin of those most first few cases, no? The 44 cases of what they call mysterious pneumonia during that time in 2019. And there were hypotheses that it came from animals. It really came from exotic animals, wherein these animals were really brought to this market, and they did testing of some of these animals, and they found not so conclusive results that the virus originated from it. First, it was a snake, it was a pangolin. Mm-hmm. But in this particular report, I think the WHO has really looked into the data because it resembles a lot more of the virus. And I hope we can get a conclusive report in the next few days, because for me, the implication here is that if this is coming from an animal, then there's a possibility that it can recur again, and we can have another SARS-CoV-2 or worse. It can mutate into these animals and become more virulent. No? And in looking into an infectious disease, we need to identify if these animals are carrying this without being infected and possibly transporting or transmitted to a human again, then that will be dangerous.
Mm-hmm. This specific research tells us something new about, introduces something, a new idea that centers on raccoon dogs being the infected. But then again, is it, was there enough evidence to show that these animals were the ones who brought the disease to us? Or is it possible that it was humans who infected raccoon dogs? Is this a cause for further concern?
Yes, I think in this particular investigation is that for me, I don't. It's not really coming from human. I still believe that this came from an animal, whether that animal is an accidental host or an intermediate host, meaning it's within that animal and then it was transmitted to a human being. That's so difficult to really think it over that it can easily transfer to humans. No? So there are really a lot of things to look into that. No, because most of the infections in animals will only be in animals, and it takes a lot of mutations. Meaning, it has to change its makeup so that it can transfer to a human being.
Right.
So that our immune system cannot recognize it. No, so that's usually the pattern of an animal to human transmission. But I believe that. I still believe that most of these viral infections, especially this magnitude of spread, can still be traced to an animal. What animal is that? We don't know. But the implication there is we need to identify so that in future pandemics, we can also look at how it is transmitted and what is the behavior of this virus when it is from an animal and be transmitted to a human being.
And what would you say are the biggest challenges as to uncovering where exactly the virus originated, Dr. Sulente? Why is this data so hard to come by?
Well, for this data in with the SARS-CoV-2 in China, it's important, no, the sharing of the data. For now, I think the Chinese CDC has not been able to share it completely to other experts. So I think that would really be critical, because sharing data with other scientists will also expand the understanding, no, on how these viruses will behave. Because for now, it's only China who has this particular data. And I think it's also the request of the WHO that they also share it to them, so that they can also further study this particular sequence of this virus that was isolated from raccoon dogs.
Mm-hmm. And as mentioned, despite the difficulty to determine the COVID origin because of the lack of transparency from Chinese authorities, but what then needs to be examined? And given our resources, how should scientists go about this?
Well, it's important that we continue to search for this, no? But whether how important it is in terms of looking at and pinpointing the origin of SARS-CoV-2, it depends, no, on how we look at it. If this will be give importance of preventing another pandemic of the same virus but a more virulent, then for me, I think that's the more important part there, why we need to look for the origin of this virus, whether what animal, and we have to study why this virus was able to jump from that animal, what makes it more virulent and make fit to jump into a human being, and what is the composition of that particular virus to evade the immune system of a human being. I think that's always the implications here, because any time a virus that is coming from an animal and jumping into human, we will always be vulnerable. And that will be an important aspect of future prevention of a pandemic.
Mm-hmm. So it's also important to identify which kinds of animals could be carriers of the virus.
Yes, precisely. No, and in fact, there are data to tell us that not only raccoon dogs, there are a lot of these animals that where they did sequencing, mm-hmm. and there are mutations that are compatible with the SARS-CoV-2. Some of them, like the hamster, there was a dog, there was a mink that was really similar to that. But again, for now, I think the closest among these animals that they were able to identify in terms of when they look at the sequences of the SARS-CoV-2, I think the closest was the raccoon dog that was isolated in the Wuhan market.
Mm-hmm. And what other hypotheses on how COVID entered the human population are still on the table and are plausible enough?
Yeah, I think if you've heard news lately, it was something like from a laboratory leak that the virus was coming from a laboratory, and it has transmitted to a human, accidentally transmitted to a human being. I think that particular theory has been of low credibility, of low what we call this significance. No, I think the CDC has declared that it's not much of an importance. But for me, I think we have to look at other angles also. And I think one of the prime important angles now is which animals does this virus originated? And for me, we need to identify that for us to really move on and study the behavior of this virus. More on really, Nikki, no, on preparing for the next pandemic. If there's a SARS-CoV-1, if there's a SARS-CoV-2, then there's a possibility that we can have also a SARS-CoV-3, 4, or even 5. No? And that we don't know. When will it occur and what animal is carrying it? And that's why continuous surveillance, monitoring of these viruses should be in place, even if the cases are going down now.
And Dr. Ronchi, was the one you were saying earlier referring to China claiming COVID originated in a lab in Maryland, U.S.? Any data to back up this hypothesis?
Well, for now, all of these are yet preliminary data, no? And it's difficult to really conclude at this point in time. There may be speculations at our end, but it's only the people that who are really handling and doing the test at this point that they can really validate this information. And I would say that just not to put fire more on the speculations, we have to wait for the official investigation, and it should be coming from a highly reputable organization. Mm-hmm. I'm pertaining to WHO before we need to be promoting or spreading some misinformation about the origin of this virus.
Do you think we should be ruling out biological warfare as well, Dr. Ronchi?
Well, that's the more dangerous part of it, no? Because if there is a possibility that it came from an animal, then there are what we call people with a bad intention can also tinker on that, and can also possibly use that as a possible biological warfare. It may not be a virus that is really ideal for a biological warfare, but knowing, you know, how it causes in terms of the spread of the virus in just a few months during the first year of the pandemic, then it needs to really be monitored, because we don't know when the next SARS-CoV-3 or SARS-CoV-4 will evolve and become a more virulent one, causing more mortality that we should prevent at this point in time.
Mm-hmm. And we have FBI Director Christopher Wray saying earlier this month that the Bureau believes COVID most likely still originated in a Chinese government-controlled lab. Is this the foremost theory of most scientists?
Again, Nikki, these are really speculations, no? And it's difficult to validate until such time that there is a formal investigation, a formal result coming from a highly organized and reputable organization. So anything that is not coming from a WHO, we just have to take those information as something that's speculative at this point in time.
Mm. I was going to ask Dr. Ronchi, are we ever going to be certain where and where and how COVID came to be? Do you think we'll ever get conclusive data?
It may be important, but for now, since we have been like 4th year of the pandemic, it's nice to know information, but I think it's important that, for me, not so important if it's coming or where is it coming from, the original, but the data that we have now for SARS-CoV-2, the mutations, the ability to mutate, and the other characteristic of the virus is an important information in terms of knowing and understanding that a virus at this point in time with the level of the characteristic that SARS-CoV-2 can be again experienced. No? There is a possibility that we can have another type of this virus that can cause an epidemic. And I think the concern now is this the ability of this virus to really mutate and adapt to the immune system of a human being and still be able to infect that human being. And that's the reason why our recommendations for vaccine changes a lot of times. First, we have the primary series, and then we added the booster in order to sustain our protection because of the mutation. And now the question is, what's next? Is the bivalent vaccine enough to protect us against the further mutation of this virus, or do we need a regular booster of COVID vaccine for us to sustain that population immunity? These are all questions that at this point in time we don't know. Until such time, we know the full behavior of this virus in terms of its ability to mutate.
And Dr. Ronchi, let's take a look at how COVID got to enter the Philippines in the first place. We just passed our 3-year anniversary of our first lockdowns here. Can you take us back? How did we take the news when COVID first entered the country?
Yeah, incidentally, Nikki, no, I was also the first one who saw that first case of COVID-19 in the Philippines. Initially,
tell us more on that.
Yes, the Chinese couple was coming from a vacation. They came from Wuhan, then they arrived here in Manila. They went to Dumaguete, and then the first time that they had symptoms of fever and cough, the couple, they went back to Manila. They consulted the local private hospital in Manila, where I'm also the consultant. They called me, and there I was really suspecting that it was COVID because they came from mm-hmm. Wuhan, and the incubation from the time that they arrived from Wuhan, that's like only 2 weeks, which is really compatible with that, no? So they were transferred here to San Lazaro Hospital, and we really have a very limited knowledge about the virus, but we were prepared for that, no? Because we already have some sort of setup here in San Lazaro Hospital for isolation of respiratory infections. And mm-hmm. During the first few days, the patient was really okay, but on the second week, that's the time that the patient deteriorated. And during that time, it's really mm-hmm. scary because we don't have treatment, and we don't know what's the extent of the infection to that particular individual. Although we know that we were preparing for all the precautions in terms of the personal protective equipment, the face mask, the full attire of PPE. But there are really a lot of questions then. How are we going to treat this patient when that patient became severe, knowing that this patient is a foreigner and don't have any relatives here in the Philippines? It's really a big challenge for us during that time because, one, we don't have treatment. Second, it took us 2 weeks before we got the sample that it was positive, because then, by then, during that time, we usually send our samples to RITM, and RITM send the samples to Australia for confirmation. So the turnaround time from the time you got the sample is usually take 1 week or more than a week.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's been 3 years. How have we evolved in treating COVID, not just medically, but also concerning our border controls and the like?
I think because of the way we look at COVID now, that it can be prevented by wearing the appropriate face mask, including the ability of us to be protected with vaccines. We have changed, no, the way we look at it in terms of border control, in terms of testing. When you go out, go to another country, or you go to another place, we have lifted that out because we know that with appropriate face mask and at the same time with full vaccine, then there is ample protection that you will not develop the severe disease. We changed the mindset now that vaccine will not protect us against infection, but mm-hmm. it will protect us against the more severe form of the infection. That's why we continue to wear the face mask so that our ability to get the infection is also lessened, but we get the vaccine because if ever we will be getting the infection, we will not be developing the severe form of COVID.
Mm-hmm. And that being said, do you think, knocking on wood, should we ever face yet another pandemic? I mean, we are still recovering, but should we ever have the misfortune of actually having yet another pandemic, would we be able to contain it this time around?
Well, that's the possibility, that another pandemic, but I think what the government is really embarking now is how should we prepare for it, and we should be prepared for it, no? So it's important that the healthcare facility should be ready for that, and I think that's part of the priority of this government, wherein we make to a point that hospitals will have the isolation rooms, will have the necessary equipment to deal with those patients who will have the severe infection. And at the same time, I think a very important learning for us is the realization that vaccine will play an important role in terms of controlling a pandemic, no? And at this point, Nikki, I would really like to emphasize again, no, that there are still a lot of what we call vaccine-preventable diseases that can be a potential threat to become a pandemic. And one of that is flu. You know? Mm-hmm. And it's important that at this point in time, we encourage everyone to get their flu shot, you know, to prepare for any outbreak of flu. But again, the more essential part here is really, really keep ourselves healthy and keep ourselves in terms of the vaccines that we are promoting, recommending to be updated also.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for speaking to us this morning, Dr. Ronjin Salate. As always, you stay safe.
Thank you, Nikki, and good morning.